which room you will go to. As a note, Professor Parker's normal office hours ended today, so you should see Canvas if you want to go see her office hours this week, and I think also on Monday, you said. I'll have my normal office hours tomorrow. We have a number of review sessions scheduled. Wednesday with Ryan, he's going to be running two of them, one at noon and one at 5. Those are in L10 Web. Note, these are rooms on the sort of smaller side. Unfortunately, we couldn't get larger rooms for this. They hold about 60 people. We don't anticipate there being a huge onslaught. However, you may want to get there a few minutes early. There'll also be then a review session on Friday with Boo and Jack, and that's going to be at 3:30 in L105 Web, which is a larger room. All right, so lots and lots of review sessions to help you guys with the exam, which is also what we're talking about today. So no new content, or if there is something that's new to you, well, I encourage you to go back and look at the lectures. As a reminder, the final exam is only, it's not a final, it's just the final exam. It's going to cover everything in the course from the last exam forward. Okay? So we're not going to explicitly test you on things from the first half of the course, unless there's things that rely on that content. For example, we've talked a lot about different structures that use maybe a linked list, so you need to understand the pros and cons of using linked lists and the costs and things like that, okay? But we won't explicitly ask you about the sorting algorithms, for example, that we covered in that first half of the semester. What we are going to talk about is, what we are going to include is what's on the next two slides. And what I've done today is I've pulled some poll questions as well as one or two slides of overview for each one of these topics. So we're just going to, you know, go through a high-level overview. I'll ask you guys a few questions, and then feel free at any point. We're not going to do questions on the poll today. Just raise your hand and we can have a discussion. I'm not anticipating necessarily we'll get through all these slides, but we'll see. But they will be posted in completion. So, okay, what's on the exam? Trees, including terminology. You have to understand the difference between like a leaf node and an inner node. What do we mean by height and depth and things like that? Including binary trees, including the different types of traversals that we have for going through a binary tree. Binary search trees, including operations, costs, and balanced versus unbalanced and implications of that. Graphs, vertices, edges, undirected, directed, unweighted, and weighted. The notion of sparse versus dense. Different storage options that you have for storing a graph data structure. And then the different the set of different algorithms that we went through for finding paths, breadth first, depth first, and Dijkstra's, as well as the topological sort algorithm. Hash tables, we talked about several different strategies for resolving collisions, so what those are and the implications of those, understanding what a load factor is, different operations and costs associated with the hash. Binary heaps, we talked about complete trees, how we can implicitly represent them as arrays, and then a variety of different operations and costs associated with a binary heap. We talked about min-max heaps. We talked about, you know, not in great depth, but we did briefly cover self-balancing binary search trees, specifically the AVL tree as well as the red-black. We talked about heap sort. It's the only sorting algorithm that we really talked about in this half of the semester. We briefly talked about the notion of what does it mean to be a stable versus unstable sort. We talked about Huffman compression, the Huffman algorithm for compressing files. We talked about quickly about quick select, and then you also had a lovely module on ethics last week. Whew. That is the second half of the class. Good job. And that is what will be covered on this next exam. All right, any questions before we start digging into some of this content? Go. Okay, so trees. So you want to make sure, you know, we had a couple of slides that talked about the different terminology, and it's not because we just expect you to memorize, but terminology is really important for making sure that we are precisely talking about the same things. So we have the notion of what does it mean to be a root, to be a parent versus children nodes, leaf nodes as well as inner nodes. Anyone want to remind us when I say, how do you compute the depth of a node? What's the depth of a node?
It's the number of ancestors.
Yes, the number of hops it takes to get back to the root. So what is the depth of the rightmost leaf node here? I see a couple of you going like this. It's 3, right? Okay. So what's our definition for the height of a tree? Exactly, it's the depth of the deepest node. Great. All right, so you might as well keep your whatever device you're doing this on, because there's going to be quite a few of these throughout. Question is, which of the following traversals is the node processed after the recursive calls to the children are complete? Sorry. Oh, wait, my bad. I'm realizing why that wasn't working. Majority of you answered post-order, and that is in fact the correct answer. Yep. So when we think about the different traversal orders that we have for working with a binary tree, it's really about the order in which the parent node is processed, or the work is done at the parent node with respect to its children node. And so in a post-order, you do your work on both of the children, the child subtrees, before you work on that node. Okay. What would it be for in order?
Would it go to the left, then the parent, then the right child?
Exactly. So I would process the left subtree, then I process the parent node, and then I process the right subtree. Yep. Okay, great. So this... this bit of code is, in fact, some pseudocode for doing a post-order traversal for BST. So here you can see that we evaluate, if this isn't a leaf, we evaluate the left child, then we evaluate the right child, and then we operate on that node itself. This is when we were looking at expression, when we were using a binary tree to represent an expression tree. What is the complexity of this traversal algorithm? Login, or a third of you, and then the rest of you said order n, and this is in fact a linear algorithm. Anyone want to explain to us why it's linear and not log n?
You're going through every node in the tree if you're doing traversal. So if n is the amount of nodes in the tree, it'll be over n.
Exactly. So with this traversal, we're going through and we're touching every node in the tree, and each time we process a node, we're doing constant time evaluations, but we're doing that n times. So that's how we get this to be a linear time operation. Is the complexity any different for post-order or in-order? No, the answer is no. Okay. All right, so before we go on, any questions about binary trees? No, just so that we're all on the same page, I'm not covering every single detail that you can expect to find on the exam. What my hope for this class is just to load everything back into main memory, so to speak. Okay? Just to get you guys remembering and thinking. I don't expect that most of you have necessarily started studying, but just to get you, again, remembering the content that we covered, okay? But so this is not an exhaustive review, just so you know. Okay, so if there's no questions on binary trees, we will go on. Binary. Yeah.
So for binary trees, adding or removing complexity, because there's no structure,
So for just a binary tree, what would the complexity be for add? Does anyone remember? For just a plain old binary tree?
It would be constant, right? Because you would just be adding something to the end, the bottom row.
How do you know where the bottom row is?
I guess we need to use recursion, so it might be log n.
Okay.
It would be the height.
Right, and
that,
so...
What that translated to in terms of n would depend on how balanced the tree was.
Right, and so if it's perfectly balanced, what is the height?
Log n.
Log n. If it's perfectly unbalanced, what's the height?
N.
N, exactly. Okay. And so for remove, what do we have to do? What's that complexity like?
So that would depend on what you want to remove. You have three different cases. Whether it's a leaf node, or just like a regular leaf node, or whether you're deleting a node with one child or two.
Okay. And so I want you to remember that with just a plain old binary tree, we don't have any restrictions. We have no order property here, right? We don't necessarily have to maintain any sort of order when we add or remove. We can kind of put them wherever in the general case. But if you wanted to remove, the first thing you have to do is actually find it, right? And so if we don't have any order property, what's the complexity of finding something in the worst case in a binary tree? It would be linear, and why is that?
Because you don't know where it is. I mean, it would basically be a leaf list at that point, and so you have to iterate through until you find it, so the average is going to be linear.
Right, exactly. So we don't know where it is, so there's a chance we're going to have to go and look at every single node in the tree, so that's going to give us a linear cost just to find it.
I think it's linear, but I would not say it's a linked list. I don't think that's true.
Right. So remember, the definition for binary tree is what makes it different from a generic, like from a linked list?
It can have two children.
Right. Exactly.
What would be an organized method for searching for the item you want to delete? That we saw just a few slides ago.
Very good.
Great.
So would it have to be an in-order traversal?
It could be any of them.
Okay. Yeah.
But the point is they were linear. The point is they were linear.
Yes.
Good.
Okay, so anything else before we move on? All right, so from here, binary trees get more interesting. Okay, so for example, let's talk about binary search trees. So what's special about a binary search tree over just the generic binary tree? So there's an order property with these nodes, right? It's not that it's necessarily sorted, but there's an order property. And that order property is, as you said, has a restriction on the ordering of the nodes such that all items in the left subtree of a node are less than the node, and all items in the right subtree are greater than the node. Okay? That's what makes a binary search tree more specific than just a binary tree in general. Work through it anyway. Is this a binary search tree? If you know the answer, then figure out why it is or isn't. Make sure you can convince yourself. Said no, does anyone want to maybe ask a question or why did you say no? Can we help determine?
I said no because even though it can very well be
answers. So maybe I should have had a third answer, not enough information to determine. So for example, what if my sorting criteria or my ordering criteria was based on the number of characters of in the string? Would this be a binary search tree? No. Okay. First of all, also because it's not a set, right? But so in fact, this, you know, there was an implicit assumption that this was based upon alphabetical ordering. And based upon that, this is in fact a binary search tree. Any other reasons people said no that they want to ask a question about? Okay. Let's see. Okay, so which of the following best describes the running time of finding the minimum item in a left-heavy binary search tree, i.e. a binary search tree that has no right children? This is a very unbalanced binary search tree. It's very left-heavy. What's the running time of finding the minimum item? Best describes. Best. See what you guys did. All right, so some of you said based upon the height of the tree, which I won't say is incorrect, but I think if we wanted to compare answers, the best answer would be linear with the number of nodes in the tree, okay? Because height is not very specific. All right, so when we talk about running time, we don't talk about it in terms of age, we talk about it in terms of n, the number of nodes. Right? Okay, so looks like most of you at least got the idea that in a left-heavy binary search tree, where is that minimum item? All the way at the very end, right? So you have to basically go down and touch every single item until you get to the very end one to find it. Okay, so similar question. Which of the following best describes the running time of finding any item in a balanced binary search tree? All right, great. So the majority of you selected logarithmic. Right, so if it's balanced, worst case scenario is that we have to go all the way down to a leaf node. But the leaf nodes are how many hops down from the root? Log n in a balanced tree. Great. Okay. So then when we talk about binary search trees, removing things, leaving things out of the tree becomes a little bit more complicated because we have to maintain this order property. There's three different cases that we talked about. The first one is when you delete a leaf node. The second one is deleting a node with a one-child subtree. And the third case is deleting a node with two children subtrees. So remember, when you have to delete something, your first step is finding it, okay? When we have to delete something, if we have to find it, we just do a regular search for a binary search tree, which is... what's our sort of average and worst case running time for finding something in a binary search tree? I just want to find an item. What's the complexity of that? Who said that?
Log n, right?
Because chances are you're going to need to go down to the leaf node or down to the leaf. Okay, so then, Okay, so then, given those cases, what is the complexity of deleting a node with no children? So basically that first case. Assume we've already found the node to delete. And if we have a node with no children, what's it called? A node with no children is a leaf node. Great. All right, let's see what you guys said. Good, so most of you said it's constant time, that's right. So case one, for deleting a leaf node, there's nothing, you just delete it and set its parent pointer to null. Okay, so let's, same question, but this time for case three. So now I have a node that has two children, and I need to delete it. What's the complexity of that? So you have to remember what it is you have to do in this case. So you said, and then we'll remind ourselves what it means to delete to this, what this case means. Okay, so majority of you said log n, which is correct. Anyone want to talk us through when we have to delete a child that has or a node that has two children? Just at a high level, what's the algorithm for doing that? What do we do? So why does that give us a login complexity?
Because for certain things in the DSP, there's a problem. And so you have to control what's going to be the problem.
Right, because you can imagine, what if you wanted to delete the root? You need to find the leftmost child in the right subtree. Okay? Find the leftmost child in the right subtree, which basically means you may need to traverse down the whole tree, which is log n. Why do we take the leftmost child in the right subtree? Does anyone have something slightly more satisfying than that? Yeah.
Of the elements that are greater than our root, the leftmost one is the smallest of the things that were greater than the node. So that is the one that will, if put in the place of the root, will maintain the order of the tree.
In theory, is that the only rule that we could have followed?
No.
What would be the other rule?
You could also take the rightmost child of the left subtree.
Right. But in this class, is that what we do?
No.
Okay, great. So that's the more complicated case three. Okay, so then which of the following trees is the result of adding C to the binary search tree in the upper right? And we're doing alphabetical order. So add C to that binary search tree and then select the resulting tree. Deleting 2. So 2 is the node I want to delete, so I delete it. And now what is 5's left child? Okay, great. Yep, it's going to be 3. So that's this case 2 example that we didn't have a question about. Okay, so case 2 is when you're deleting a node that only has one child. And all you do is replace that node with its child. Okay? And then, what node will replace 5 after deleting 5? If I want to delete 5, what's going to end up there? So the answer is, in fact, 6. So 5 is an example of which case? Case 3, which is what?
Two children,
exactly. And so in case 3, we replace the node with the leftmost child in the right subtree, which is 6. Okay? All right, so that's all I have on BSTs. Any questions before we move on?
We said that case 1 and 2 are both constant if we already found the node.
Yes, exactly, yes. So the complexity of deleting for cases 1 and 2 is constant after you have found the node, which is log n. Any other questions? Okay, great. So let's talk about graphs. So we talked about graphs after talking about trees. So trees are, in fact, a subset of graphs. So a graph is a more general data structure. A graph is just a set of vertices that are connected by edges. An edge is a link between two vertices. Vertices do not, we no longer have this notion of a parent-child relationship. Edges can be bidirectional, and they can also be weighted. All right. So at least in this class, when we've talked about graphs, largely what we've talked about and cared about is the notion of finding a path through a graph. So a path is a sequence of nodes with a start point and an endpoint, such that the endpoint can be reached through a series of nodes from the start point. Okay. Is there anything about our definition of path that says anything about the number of nodes in the path or the weight of the edges in the path? No. So we have a couple. What are some of the special paths that we more likely care about? Do we care about just any old path? Yeah. The shortest path is definitely one of the things we care about.
Yeah.
And the cheapest path, exactly. So what algorithm would I use to find the shortest path?
Breadth first search.
Breadth first search. What would I use to find the cheapest path?
Dijkstra's.
Dijkstra's. You guys love Dijkstra's, right?
Yeah.
New favorite. Okay. Great. So, oh my gosh. Yeah. All right. Anyway, so much for cut and paste. Okay. Is a linked list a graph? Great. Right. So the answer is, in fact, yes, right? You can think of a linked list as simply a bunch of vertices with edges between them. Okay. Is a linked list a directed graph or an undirected graph?
Directed.
That's right. And a doubly linked list, what's special about the edges there? It's bidirectional. Yeah, so if we wanted to think about a linked list or talk about it in terms of a graph, that's how we would talk about it. Great. Okay, so depth, let's talk, so depth first search. It's like the stepchild of the other two because why do we care about it? But if we think about depth-first search, this is our recursive algorithm for finding a path. It'll recursively search from, so you start with the start node, and you recursively search from that node into its neighbor, and into its neighbor, and into its neighbor. And if there's no more edges, you return and go to the next neighbor at that node, and so on. When we do depth-first search, you have to make sure that when we visit a node, we mark it as visited so that we don't end up in cycles. And so when we're doing our traversal, we want to check, have we already visited this node? If so, then we don't go and visit it again. For each node visited, we want to save a reference to the node where it came from so we can reconstruct a path. Right, so we need to save these breadcrumbs so that we know like how we got somewhere. Is depth-first search guaranteed to find the path if it exists?
Yes.
Could depth-first search give you the shortest path? What would be the condition in which it would allow you to find the shortest path?
The shortest path is always the one that comes off the first edge.
Exactly. If the shortest path just happens to be the path that takes the first neighbor in each node's neighbor list, is that likely to be the case? No. No. All right. So then we talk about breadth first search, which, as we said, is the algorithm. Oh, sorry. Good question.
If you want to visit all the nodes. Right? I mean, as we have studied BFS and Dijkstra's, we always stop early when we get to something, right? Mm-hmm. So DFS is a good general sort of traversal of the nodes.
That's right, because what's the data, what's the extra thing we use in breadth first and Dijkstra's that we don't use in depth first? What does BFS and Dijkstra's have that depth first does not? A priority queue.
Well, BFS is just a queue.
Queue, right. Yeah.
I think maybe depth first search could be good if you expect your answer to be somewhere toward the bottom, too. Toward like the bottom, like deep in the tree.
don't confuse trees and grass.
Yeah, there's not necessarily an explicit notion of bottom. So I understand what you're saying, but how you would actually describe that or imagine you'd be able to describe that algorithmically is pretty tough. You'd have to know quite a bit about the structure of your graph and the way things are laid out in order to be able to know that. But there is a chance that for a search could find a path faster than something.
If you don't care about the length of the path, implementing breadth first or dag first is a lot of extra work. Because you could just do depth first.
Yep, right. So depth first has this really nice recursive property, right? And if you remember, we did talk about recursion in the beginning of the semester, so we require you to remember what recursion is. But these algorithms can be quite elegant. You know, very few lines of code have done well. So they can be really easy to understand as well, whereas both breadth first and Dijkstra's require this extra data structure, a queue or a priority queue depending on the algorithm. Yeah. Okay. Anything else before we briefly talk about breadth first?
So depth first, is it all in it?
No.
But then you could say you
could use it to visit all the nodes.
You can use it to visit all the nodes. So the other thing we've talked about a lot is always having the same starting node, and there's a more general idea of these algorithms where you start at each node and you know, traverse a path. So you know, you need to sort of generalize your idea of what we're doing with these graphs if all you want to do is visit each node. Okay. So DFS is sort of it's a more general algorithm that will allow you to accomplish more things. One thing we didn't say, one terminology we didn't talk about is whether you have a connected or disconnected graph. So if your graph is connected, then DFS will visit every node by starting at only one node. So connected means everything's connected at least to something else. Right?
What if the path is found before it visits all the nodes?
Say that again?
What if the path is found before it visits everything?
Well, so again, it depends on what you're trying to accomplish with the algorithm. So if you're trying to find a certain path, like you want to get to a certain ending index, then you would do what we already do for BFS and Dijkstra's, which is just stop early.
But maybe there's something that you're doing over your entire graph data structure. You want to update some value at the nodes. Right? So then you would need to visit everything. When your goal is not necessarily to find a path.
So you wouldn't necessarily stop when you found the goal.
Right.
Exactly. Is there another hand up over here? Okay. All right. So breadth first search. So as we talked about, the point of breadth first search is really to find the what path? Shortest. Yep. So as opposed to depth first with BFS, what we do is we want to visit all the shallower nodes first. So this idea that we start at a node, we look at all of its, what we might call one ring neighbors, all of its first neighbors, and then all of their neighbors, and then all of their neighbors. So it's a breadth type of search as opposed to going deep. This requires an additional data structure. We use a queue. So we start by having a queue. We put the starting node in the queue. And then we enter into our while loop that while the queue is not empty, we dequeue the current node. And for each unvisited neighbor of the current node, we mark it as visited and we put it in the queue. And then you keep going until you find your goal node. Notice that it's not recursive. It just runs until the queue is empty. All right, so looking at this little graph, what path will breadth first search from B, find from B to C? So breadth first search is going to find the shortest path, which is in fact from B to E and then from E to C. Okay. Okay, so next question. What is true of depth first search when searching from a start node to a goal node? The path exists, it'll find it. It's guaranteed to find the shortest path. It's guaranteed not to find the shortest path. It must be careful about cycles, and then various combinations of those answers. All so, most of you answered G, which is the correct answer. So it will find a path if it exists, and you have to be careful about cycles. But whether or not you find the shortest path, you may or you may not. You have no guarantees on that. Okay, so for this one, now we're asking about breadth-first search from a start node to a goal node, and it's the same set of options. Questions on BFS before we move along?
This is actually one of the questions on the analysis document, which it's already due. I figured I might as well ask. There's a question that talked about finding the shortest path from a node to every other node in the graph, and what I was thinking for that was just to take off the like the return whenever you find what you're looking for, so it just goes through the whole graph. Is that the right idea?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So we have that restriction about when we find it, we're done, and you remove that restriction, and in the meantime, you keep track of where things came from.
And that was the point I was making earlier about BFS and Dijkstra's, is the algorithms actually don't stop early by default. We've added that because there's no point in continuing. But by default, they are algorithms for finding the shortest or cheapest paths from a start to every other node that there is a path to. So those costs we gave you, that's what that's the cost for. If you stop earlier, it could cost less.
Yeah. Other questions? All right, topological sort. We didn't spend too much time on this, but it does require a graph that has no cycles. But what a topological sort does is it orders nodes such that if there's a path from node A to node B, then A appears before B in the sorted order. So it's really great for doing things like scheduling tasks, or we looked at a running example, which is how do you determine which classes to take to ensure you've gotten prereqs in the most efficient way possible. So you can represent tasks as a graph, and task A must be completed before task B, then A has an edge to B. Okay, so the way that it works is we have this notion of an in degree. So the in degree of a node is the number of edges it has coming into it. This can be saved as part of a node class and can be easily computed as the graph is constructed. And then anytime a node adds another node as a neighbor, you increase the neighbor's in degree. And then the algorithm works based upon that in degree. So at a high level, what we do, just to remind you, is we step through each node in the graph, and if any node has in degree 0, add it to the queue. So how might we step through every node in the graph? What would we want to do if we want to make sure we visit every node in a graph? For example, right? We were just actually talking about this, right? Like when you might use something like depth-first search without ending early for a path. So if I wanted to visit every node, here's an example of where I would do that. So for topological sort, the first thing I need to do is find all my nodes that have an in degree of 0, okay? So once you've done, so if you find 0, you put it into your queue, and then while the queue isn't empty, you dequeue the first node in the queue and add it to the sorted list. Then you visit that node's neighbors and decrease their in degree by 1. And if any neighbor's new in degree is 0, you add it to the queue. Okay? And that's all I have on that. I wasn't going to step through that whole... In the lecture slides, if none of this rings a bell, go back. There's a detailed example with courses and prereqs there. Okay? Any questions about this?
So, at the third bullet point of number 2, when it says if the neighbor's new in degree is 0, add it. If the in degree is 0, doesn't that mean it has no incoming edges, and so it can't be a neighbor?
At that point, it doesn't have any anymore.
Oh, okay.
Right, because you basically took something out of the queue, and you make you decrease all of its neighbors by 1 because it's now going to be removed.
Okay.
Exactly. Good question. Any other questions? Okay. Dijkstra's. Oh my gosh, you guys are experts at this now, right? I can just skip this. But I won't. Okay, so Dijkstra's finds the cheapest path. You keep track of the total path cost from the start node to the current node, And then the cost of a path to the next node is the total cost so far plus the weight of the edge to that next node. But instead of traversing nodes in the order they were encountered, you would traverse them in the order of the cheapest total cost first. Well, what's the data structure we use to do that last part? Priority queue. Priority queue, exactly. Okay, so starting at A, what path will Dijkstra's find to C? You actually have to run Dijkstra's to answer this question? No, you can just do that. All right. So we spent a little bit of time talking about the complexity of both breadth first, depth first, and Dijkstra's. And just to remind you, when we reason about the complexity of Dijkstra's, the first two things we think about is, in the worst case, I have to visit everything, right? The very last node is the one that I want to find. So in that case, I visit each node once and only once, and I have to cross each edge once and only once, okay? So what's the complexity of those first two steps there? Turns out it's the same thing we have to think about for breadth first and depth first. I have to visit each node and I have to visit each edge. Exactly. It's O of V plus E, where V is the number of vertices and E is the number of edges. Okay? However, for Dijkstra's now, we have to do work at each one of these things. So the work done at each node and edge is now going to be log V. And why is that?
Because the DQ function of priority queue is log
V. It's not the DQ, it's the what?
The
NQ, either. It's actually NQ, right? So either putting it in the queue or what's the other thing if something's already in the queue you have to do? Potentially update its cost. Exactly. So those operations are log V.
That answer is not wrong. It is logarithmic to take something out of a priority queue. The remove, the poll, the DQ for a priority queue is logarithmic.
Okay, right, so that's what we do at each node, and then at each edge, though, then we do the NQ, right? Thanks. Okay, so at the vertices, we do a DQ, so we're pulling something from the priority queue. At the edges, we're either doing an NQ or an update a cost function, which is also log V. So at each node and each edge, we're doing log V amount of work, so the total complexity for Dijkstra's is V plus E times log V. Why is it log V and not log V plus E?
Because we're just doing the work for the node while every edge of the node.
Can you be a little more explicit?
So if you want to add something to the priority,
right, exactly. So the log V is based upon the complexity of putting things in or taking things out of the priority queue. And what goes in the priority queue? The vertices. So in worst case, priority queue has all the vertices in it. Yeah, so that's where it's log V and not log V plus E. Whew. Are there questions on this? Okay. All right. Storing graphs. What are the two the two general ways that we've talked about in this class for storing graphs.
Yeah.
Adjacency list and adjacency matrix. Anyone want to explain the difference between them?
So adjacency list is where for each node you have each vertex you have a list of what it's adjacent to. And then for an adjacency graph, you just have
adjacency matrix.
Yeah. You have a matrix that lists all its connections. And so you use the matrix when it's really dense and the list when it's really sparse.
Right. Okay. Exactly. So a list is when you have for each node stores the neighboring nodes that it's connected to, or it stores a set of edges, either one of those, okay? Or the adjacency matrix is when you have a basically 2D table that the rows and the columns both represent the nodes themselves, and then each cell in that table represents a potential connection. So you could do something like 0 if there is no connection, or 1 if there isn't that connection between those two, okay? And we use adjacency matrices particularly for dense graphs, whereas we use adjacency lists for sparse graph data structures. Why wouldn't we, what's the sort of drawback of using an adjacency matrix for a sparse graph?
Because you have to, in the JV, you have to each thing represented twice in your matrix, so you
end up using. So there's a lot of empty space, right? So the size of the matrix is V squared, right? But if you don't have a lot of E's in there, that's going to be a lot of empty spaces. Yeah. Okay. Right, so adjacency list. Each vertex stores an array of adjacent vertex indices, usually as a linked list. Confirming the existence of an edge for a vertex is going to be order of EV, right? So I'm out of vertex. I just want to know, does a specific edge exist? All I have to do is look through my edge list. But iterating through all the edges is order E, so I can basically for each node go through the edges, go to the next node, and so on. The space complexity is V plus E, so that's, you know, that's great as long as, you know, V starts to get big, or if E starts to get big, then we start to go closer to a adjacency matrix size. So it's used for sparse graphs as opposed to an adjacency matrix. Where you can confirm the existence of an edge for a vertex is just concept time. It's basically a lookup table. Iterating through all the edges, however, is a V-squared operation. I have to basically visit every single cell in that table. The space complexity is also V-squared. And so this is used for dense graphs. Okay, questions?
So I might be wrong. It just doesn't seem like an adjacency matrix is useful when you're wanting to do pathfinding specifically. Just
when you're wanting to do what?
Pathfinding.
Pathfinding.
Because when you do pathfinding, you have to iterate through all the neighbors anyway, which if you have ones and zeros, you're not getting the actual thing. I'm not sure where I might be going wrong there. Is that legitimate?
So if you're pathfinding, basically you have a node, and then you have to visit that node's neighbors. Mm-hmm. So what do you have to do to find its neighbors?
You'd need a list. Would be an adjacency list anyway.
You can't get that information out of the matrix.
You could get the paths exist, but could you get the actual? Oh, I guess it would work if the edges weren't actual like objects. It would work if they were just. Actually, maybe not.
So let's just say I'm at node 0 and I want to find 0's neighbors, and all I have is this representation. How do I find its neighbors?
I was going to ask a different question.
Could you not just go through the column for the specific origin?
Yeah, so I could basically start at, let's just say I'm going to do it row-wise. I would start at 0, that 0th row, and I would step through for each column and say, we'll skip 0, because ignore the diagonal. I would go to index 1 and say, is that a 1 or a 0? If it's a 1, it means I have an edge, so I know I have an edge with vertex 1. So then I can do that. And then I would keep going. But that requires me to basically look through that whole row. So if that row, let's say I have a million vertices, that row is going to be a million vertices long, but what if I only have 3 edges in there? If I had an adjacency list, I would only have to do 3 things, whereas here I have to do a million.
Would you also have to map all of your edges to like an integer somehow?
You can store anything in those cells. This is the simplest case of just storing
sense.
A 0
okay.
at 1.
Yeah.
A fairly common solution for the last assignment was to use a hash map of hash maps that kind of made a grid sort of like this, but because it wasn't specifically like arrays, does the space complexity and the time complexity stay the same even if it was back using two hash maps?
I think space is really, really bad for that solution. Why?
Oh boy. Oops.
Why? What are hash tables really bad at? Space. You always have to have lots of extra space for hash tables to work well. So that's worse than an adjacency matrix.
But RAND really
bad. Well, it's space versus time, right? These are different things. Space and time are different things. Yeah.
I don't want to say there's no wrong answers. I'd have to say that oftentimes, especially if you start dealing with more complex problems, there's good solutions and then there's bad solutions, right? So good solutions, there's going to be a series of trade-offs. In the real world, there's always a series of trade-offs between how you make decisions. I think space versus time is one very general.
There is a little bit of a time issue there, too. How do you iterate through a hash table differently than a linked list? You have to skip over gaps that you have, right, because it is taking up so much extra space. So there, that you could have done much better on time and space, but I can see why time wasn't that bad. Yeah.
Hindsight is 20/20.
Well, no, absolutely. No, for sure. No, but it's a good question in context of this, for sure.
Other questions on this? All right, speaking of which, hash maps. Okay, so we motivated, when we talked about hash maps and hash tables, we motivated it with this up to that point. This is where we sat with our data structures. We talked about arrays, array lists, linked lists, BSTs, stacks, and queues. And we see that there's a variety of trade-offs with respect to the complexity to do various common operations such as access and search and some notes. And basically we saw that stacks and queues are pretty awesome, constant time for all of our primary operations, but with these very strong constraints that you are limited in what you could actually access. And so we motivated the notion of a hash map with this idea of what if we wanted constant time access to any item? And that's what got us to the hash map. So one of the major things we think about though with hash maps is the notion of a collision. Anyone want to remind us what is a collision in terms of a hash map?
When you go to insert something into the map and there's something already there.
Exactly. Right. So you go to insert something into your map and an item already exists there. Right. And so in that case, we had three strategies that we talked about for dealing with these collisions. Anyone want to remind us what those three strategies were, just even the names of them?
Linear probing, quadratic probing, as well as, I don't remember the name for it, but it's where you like created like a list or
chunks. Exactly, separate chain. Yep, okay, great. So if I have a collision and I'm using linear probing, what does linear probing do? It keeps iterating by one by one in your array until you find the next open slot, exactly. What's the problem once I have a collision like that? What do we call this problem that starts happening?
It creates a cluster.
Exactly.
To have more collisions after that.
Exactly. So, right. So that's the problem with collisions and using something like linear probing is now I have a collision, so I put something in the next one, but now I'm likely to have a collision with not only that initial one I had a problem with, but the next one as well. So these clusters tend to grow. So the second type of strategy we talked about was quadratic probing. What does quadratic probing do?
It's where you, if the spot that you have is filled, you check 1 squared, and if that's filled, then you check from the same original position 2 squared and so on until you find an empty spot.
Exactly. Right? So from that index where you're trying to insert it, if it's filled, you go +1 squared. then plus 2 squared, then plus 3 squared, and plus 4 squared, and so on and so on. And so with that, can we still get clustering? Yeah, and that's called secondary clustering. So that can still happen. And what's our what's the sort of trick to guaranteeing that we can at least find a spot? What is the consideration for the table? Exactly. So load factor of less than 0.5 and a table of a prime number size. Great. So, and then separate chaining, what's that strategy?
That's where you put a linked list in each of the kind of slots. So if you end up having a collision, you don't collide, you each put multiple things into one.
Exactly. You just keep adding to the end of the linked list at that spot. Right. Okay, great. And so one of these questions, though, had to do with rehashing, right? And when, and this notion of what's rehashing related to? Or what do we base rehashing on, making the decision when we do it or not?
The load factor.
The load factor, right. So what we said for quadratic probing is we want a load factor less than 0.5. And so for linear probing and quadratic probing, what is the load factor itself? Like, how do we compute the load factor?
The load factor is, wait, just for linear probing or?
Linear quadratic probing, when you're just using an array. How do you compute the load factor?
Oh, you divide the total number, the number of filled spots divided by the number of total spots.
It's the percentage of the array that's filled. And what is load factor for separate chaining?
The average length of the lists.
Right, the average length of all the lists, exactly. Great, okay, good. All right. Okay. So let's say I have this hash map. It's only partially filled. What is the load factor for the hash table that I'm showing you here? It's just an array. It's not using separate chaining. Six, that's correct. 6 out of 10 spots are filled, that's 60% full, that's the load factor. All right, so then for this one, using linear probing, in what index will the number 93 be added? Said B, which is the correct answer. I'm not sure why people would select number 1. Anyone confused by that?
I guess I was just initially confused by what the hash function was.
Sure. That's right. So good. So there is an assumption here in this question that we used hash function like what we talked about in lecture, which is using the modulo the array size.
I chose 1, and the reason why is because I was thinking differently. I was thinking it should have been 9 because the first of the two digits is 9. I thought that's the hash function we were using. So then it would go to 0 and then to 1.
Got it.
Yeah. So it was just a misunderstanding of what, how it decides where it goes.
Yep. So it's a fair assumption that if we don't specify the hash function, then assume it's modulo the array size. Other questions? I think okay, so as you can imagine.
Actually, let's be really clear. Your hash table implementation should do the modulo. I think you guys know that from your assignment, right? So actually, the hash function here is just the identity. 93 maps to 93. Okay, so don't get confused about that. It's really important if the thing that you're adding is not an integer, that you remember you're responsible for the modulo. Okay?
Did you guys all hear that? Yeah, okay. Great. So using quadratic probing, what index will 22 be added? Again, assuming identity, the identity function for your hash function. Answer is in fact 6. Right, so you start by trying to put it at 2, it's filled. So what's the next one you look at? 2 plus what? 1 squared, which is 3. And that's filled. So then 2 plus 2 squared, which is 6. Yep. All right. Goodness. Okay, so in a separate chaining hash table with a load factor equal to 1.25, what is the average length of a list? Okay, great. Most of you got that right. So it's 1.25. So remember, the load factor, or lambda, for separate chaining is the average length of the linked list in the map. Anything else on hash map before we continue?
When we're doing quadratic probing, can you go over, like, you can roll that to 0?
The wraparound? Yeah, you do wraparound just like you do with linear probing. Was that the question?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. You treat it just like linear probing, but instead of going index by index by index, you do these leaps, but you do wrap around as well. Anything else?
Wait, with the load factor, like the example we gave, if you only have one item in 5 spaces, what the average length you want to fit?
If you have five, your hash map is of size 5, let's say you have 5 things in it. If you have them all in one, or if you have one in each of them, it'll give you the same value.
I just measure.
All right, binary heaps. Okay, so a binary heap is a binary tree with 2 special properties. So it has a structure. So now this is where we started talking about structure properties. So it has a structure property, which is that it's a complete tree, and an order property in that the data in any node is less than or equal to the data of its children. Does anyone want to remind us what a complete tree is?
Every node has the full 2 children, it must be on the last row or it's filled from left to right.
Exactly. So every level of your tree is filled with the exception of the last level, which is filled from left to right. Yep. Okay, so this is also referred to as a min heap. So we can talk about a max heap, which has this opposite order property. And the reason that these heaps exist in the world is really for backing priority queues. Right? So we just talked about complete trees. So because of this nice structure property, under the hood, we're going to implicitly represent our complete tree as an array. So we know the root is going to go at index 0, its left child goes at index 1, its right child goes at index 2, and so on. So what this allows us to do is to have these nice analytic expressions to be able to go to any node's children or any node's parent. Okay? So when we work with min or max heaps, we have to be really careful when we're adding or removing things to maintain our two properties for these trees and the structure and the order. Which one do we take care of first?
Structure,
exactly. So we always take care of structure first, and then we deal with the order. When we deal with the order, we think about, we talked about percolating up or down. So that's the next one. We deal with the structure property first. Okay. So where does the new item go in order to maintain the structure property? If we're adding something to a tree, where does the new item go? Yes, so the leftmost open node on the bottom level. Exactly, the end of the tree. And then what we want to do is that when we add something, we then percolate the item upward until we restore the order property with its parents along its path to the root. All right, so what is the runtime behavior of find min for a binary min heap? Behavior find min for a binary max heap. Okay, interesting. Where is the max? Where is the minimum value if I have a binary max heap? Anyone want to raise their hand and tell me where I find the min value in a max heap? Yeah. On the last level. Is that it's on the last level. Yeah. Right, so what do I have to do to find them in? Isn't it what?
Well, let's be very clear what we mean by last level. It is a leaf node. Okay? It is a leaf node. And how many leaf nodes are there in a tree with n nodes? About n over 2, right? So you won't have to look at every node, but it's just as bad as linear because you'll have to look at half of them.
Do you guys hear that?
Okay. And let me also point out while we're talking about this, I've heard so many students misspeak and call a heap sorted, and it's really not. It's not keeping order as carefully as you're imagining, okay? So really be sure that you can distinguish between a BST and a binary heap. They're very different in how they work.
And that's why we stress this notion of an order property. It's ordered. It's different than sorted. Okay. All right, next question. What is the runtime behavior of adding some random value for a binary heap in the worst case? That's right. so what is the worst case value that I add? Let's say I have a min heap. What's the worst case value that I add?
You add a new min.
I add a new min, right. And so if I add the new min, the first thing I do is take care of structure property, go to the very end of the tree, and then I'm going to have to percolate up how many levels? Log n, right, to get it to the root. Yep. Okay. And what's the runtime behavior for adding some random value in the average case? Answer is constant time. Anyone want to reason about why? Why is that constant time in the average case?
Because in the binary heap, most of your values are in the bottom two rows, and so you expect that you'll probably end up putting it into one of those two rows.
Right, so roughly 75% of the nodes end up in those bottom two levels in a heap, and so chances are that within one or two swaps, you're going to find where something goes in the average case. So that's a constant time.
This is a great example of something you learn instead of memorize. So a lot of students are like, I can't seem to memorize that adding in a heap is constant on average when it's logarithmic in the worst case. And you don't need to memorize. You just need to reason about how far do you expect to percolate in each of these cases. Okay?
All right. All I got on? Min max heaps. We're good? Okay. So I have a min max heap now, which is just an extension of the heap order property. Or if you remember now, even at every node in an even depth is a minimum element of its subtree, and every node in an odd depth is a maximal element of its subtree, and the root is considered at an even depth. So it looks something like, so this is an example of a min max heap. Min levels are the odd levels, max levels are the even levels. I'm sorry, min are the even, max are the odds. Okay, where is the smallest item in a min-max heap? Yeah, the root net, it's always the root. Where is the largest item? The second level. Where's the second largest item? It's the other one on the second level? Is that true? It's not necessarily true. Okay, so the order property ensures that your largest item will in fact be on that first max level, but it doesn't guarantee anything about the second largest. You just have to ensure the order property. Again, this is the difference between things being ordered versus being sorted. Okay? Questions? Okay, so we talked about self-balancing binary search trees. Now we went through this pretty quickly, okay? We're not gonna expect you to understand all the nitty-gritty details of these algorithms. What are the two self-balancing DSPs we talked about? ABL and red and black, right. So an ABL is a binary search tree, but that has a structure property with it. Namely that the height of the left and right subtrees of any node can differ by at most one. And the difference is called the balance factor. So after we insert something or delete something from an ABL tree, the nodes on the path from the root to the updated node may become unbalanced. And so in order to rebalance the entire tree, we only have to think about balancing along that path. And so depending upon the location of the inserted node, we either have to do these single rotations or we saw these double rotations to restore balance. Red-black trees also have a structure property. It's a little bit different than an ABL. The longest path from the root to any leaf is no more than twice as long as the shortest path from the root to any other leaf in the tree. which is really complicated. But instead, what you can do for red black trees is think about the set of constraints that actually enforce that. So a node is either red or black. The root is always black. If a node is red, its children must be black, and every path from a node to a null to a leaf must contain the same number of black nodes. Okay. So we looked at some visualizations you can play around with for those. Okay, we talked about heap sort. Probably my new favorite sorting algorithm. So you build a what kind of heap? So the first step of heap sort is I want to build a blank kind of heap with the elements I have in my list to be sorted. What kind of heap do I build? Max. You build a max heap. So we create a max heap in order to sort the elements in descending order. As you remember, once the heap is... Before my second cup of coffee. Okay, once the heap is created, we then, what do? So I now have a heap, now what do? Anyone remember? About heap sort is that it's an in-place sorting algorithm. Okay? So we only have to use that one array that we have stored our items in. Okay? So using keeping this in place, what do?
Should we just remove the max and put that at like the end of the array and consider that end of the array sorted and the heap size goes down so it doesn't include that last value of the array.
Exactly. So I remove max, right? So I remove the max from my heap. And then when I remove max, I'm going to have to make sure that I maintain my heap by taking the last item in the array and percolating up where it goes. But now I have this last item in the array open, so now I place that max item at that end of the array. That's the location of the newly deleted leaf node, and I keep repeating. Okay, and so that's heap sort. Questions on that? And we're just about out of time, so I'm almost through the slides. Just really quick, I'll run through these. We talked about stable versus unstable sorts. I have a definition here for stable, which has to do with if you have key-value pairs, okay? Examples of stable sorts we've looked at are insertion and merge sort. We talked about Huffman compression. We had these six core steps that are, I think, pretty straightforward. Where the nuances are is, remember, we construct a binary tri, which gives us an encoding for characters. We'll skip the question. And we talked about quick select, which was an algorithm for selecting the k's smallest item. And what's the complexity of quick select? Anyone remember? It's a linear time algorithm, okay? It's like quick sort, only you keep having to sort the half that has the k's smallest item in it. Guys, congratulations. You guys made it to the end of the semester. Nice job.